taking the time out. This is being sponsored by three League of Women Voters leagues on the local level, the Palo Alto League. And we have the president of the Palo Alto League here, right here, Ellen Forbes. And we are in the South San Mateo County League. And Ellen Hope is there. And this is also North Central League is also sponsoring this event. The San Mateo County Leagues have placed sea level rise and the issues surrounding that as one of the countywide priorities, which is why we are holding these types of community events. This is, I think, the fourth community education event that we've had about sea level rise. And also the Bay Area League has been involved with many things, and one of which is new for it, is also sea level rise and the issues surrounding that. And we have the president of the Bay Area League, and that's Linda Craig, who's sitting right there. And recently, the Bay Area League has endorsed the measure put on by the Bay Restoration Authority supporting that tax measure. Measure AA, thank you. A little bit about the league, or leagues. We are local. We are active at the local, regional, state, and federal level. And as the name suggests, we are primarily interested in voting, not only helping people to get access to voting, but also to be knowledgeable and educated about measures that would come up, which you may need to vote on, or your representatives may need to vote on, or issues which are of great interest to people in the community. It's open to women and men, so if you're not part of the league, all of you here are eligible to be part of the league, and we encourage you to consider being part. And back there where Suzanne is standing is membership information. And we also have a list that's back there. If you're not sure about becoming a member but would like to be notified about upcoming events, you can tell us by just saying, I'd like to be notified. One of the upcoming events that we're having next month is, if you know Judge Ladoris Cordell, is going to be speaking in the Redwood City Library on a topic of why Black Lives Matter to all of us. So it's a subject which there may not be a vote on, but which there is a lot of community interest. Again, a little bit about the league. We do not support candidates, although we do have candidate forums, again, for people to know and understand the issues that are coming before them. And then based on studies, we may take a position on topics. And so just as I mentioned before, we have supported Measure AA or endorsing its passage. We have not to date taken locally any recommendation on either of these projects. Our goal here tonight is community knowledge and community education. So we are neutral on this except for passionate about knowing what's going on in the community. So again, we thank you all for being here. Just a little administrative notes before I turn it over to the speakers, and I want to thank both the City of Menlo Park as well as Len Materman from the San Francisquito Joint Powers Authority. They've really helped, and I've got a preview of these slides, and they're just awesome, and I'm really excited about hearing about this. The topic of tonight, as it shows up here, is the intersection of land use and sea level rise. And as many of you may know, along the bay side of our bay, cities are considering land use increases. And San Mateo County is one of the most, in fact, it is the most vulnerable county in the state of California to the effects of sea level rise, and that's based on the amount of development that's there now. So there are going to be increases with increased development in existing urban areas. But this is really a new kind of topic where the treads of what to do are not really well known, because this is talking about future risks as opposed to existing risks. And so the city's going to share its current thinking about what to do, but it's not clear. And I just want you to know it's not clear at any level as to what exactly needs to be done, but it is evolving. So it really may stimulate your thoughts about what may need to occur citywide or region-wide, because we're all vulnerable in the Bay Area to sea level rise and its effects. And so we have two speakers today, as you can see, from the city of Menlo Park, Deanna Chow and Azalea Mitch, and they are going to go first on the agenda. And then Len is going to share with us where we are on Safer Bay, which is looking at feasible options to help with tidal flooding given sea level rise. So at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Deanna, and welcome and thank you.
Okay, can everyone hear me? Does this sound good? Okay, great. Thank you for having us. As Anne mentioned, I am Deanna Chow. I'm a principal planner with the City of Menlo Park's Planning Department. And here with me is Azalea Mitch, who is a senior civil engineer in our Public Works Department. And tonight we're going to be providing an overview of land use and sea level rise planning efforts in Menlo Park. A little too fast there. Okay. So our agenda for this presentation is to provide a brief overview of our current planning efforts, which is the general plan update, highlight some of the development efforts that are happening in the M2 area, and then provide more information regarding sea level rise, its impacts potentially on Menlo Park, and some potential strategies that we are considering in how to address sea level rise. First of all, it's an exciting time here in Menlo Park. We are embarking on our general plan update, which we started back in 2014. The title is Connect Menlo, as shown on the screen, and it's somewhat a symbolic logo. It represents the intersection of the M2 area, which I'll discuss in a little bit more detail, but the white part showed the major road intersections of Bayfront Expressway, Highway 101, and Willow Road. And Connect Menlo serves to really demonstrate the interconnectedness between land use and mobility and people and place. So what is a general plan? It is the city's long-range comprehensive plan for future development in the city. And it's one of the seven elements of a general plan is a required by state law. There are seven elements to a general plan. In 2013, the city adopted the open space and conservation, noise and safety elements. In 2014, we updated our most recent housing element for the 2015 to 2023 planning period, and now we are focused on the land use and circulation elements. Connect Menlo, the land use and circulation elements are central components of the general plan, and there are a number of objectives that we're trying to achieve through this process, including establishing a community's vision for land use, realizing economic potential, improving mobility for all travel modes, creating sustainable land use planning. So Connect Menlo is a joint effort between staff and a consultant team led by PlaceWorks. And we also receive guidance from a general plan advisory committee, also known as the GPAC. They are a 13-member body comprised of both elected officials, representatives from various city commissions, and five at-large members who represent community residents and property owners. Our work plan consists of four major components. The first is establishing the guiding principles. We then draft our proposed goals, policies, and programs associated with the land use and circulation elements. We are also embarking on a concurrent process to provide the zoning for the potential land use changes that were described in our general plan effort, and then all of this will be reviewed through an environmental impact report that will discuss the potential environmental impacts associated with this project. One thing to note, it's been a very collaborative and comprehensive outreach process. We have had over 50 meetings of various types. We've started out with a double-decker bus tour around the city. We've had symposiums on transportation and housing. We've done online surveys, and we've had numerous community meetings, open houses, and study sessions with both the Planning Commission and City Council. So as I mentioned, we kicked off in summer of 2014, and our goal is to conclude this process in the fall of this year. So this shows the four major components and the varying stages throughout the timeline. Ooh, this is sensitive. So to provide a little context for those who may not be familiar with the city of Menlo Park, we are a long and narrow city. We span from Highway 280 all the way into the bay. We're approximately 18 acres, and 12 acres of that consist of San Francisco Bay and the wetlands. We consist of a mix of land uses, from single-family residential neighborhoods to, we're starting to see, higher density residential neighborhoods, a mix of commercial uses, institutional uses, and certainly we pride ourselves on open space. As part of Connect Menlo, though, our geographic area of focus is what we're calling the M2 area. It's the gray shaded part at the top of the screen, and the diagram on the right is an enlarged version. The M2 area is referencing the zoning district that currently exists on the land today. M2 represents what historically has been manufacturing, industrial, and today we're starting to see an evolution of more office and R&D space. And the area is generally bounded by Marsh, Bayfront Expressway, Willow Road, or excuse me, actually University Avenue and Highway 101. And the star just represents where we are today for reference. And this area here is approximately 500 acres in size. So one of the first major steps that we did for Connect Menlo was kicked off with creating our guiding principles. And these 9 guiding principles really describe the kind of place that Menlo Park wants to be. The guiding principles often overlap, as you can see, great transportation options and accessible open space lead to healthy communities. So there is definitely an interconnectedness between the 9 guiding principles. So I wanted to highlight one of our guiding principles, which is sustainable environmental planning. And I'll just read it for you. Menlo Park is a leader in efforts to address climate change, adapt to sea level rise, protect natural and built resources, conserve energy, manage water, utilize renewable energy, and promote green buildings. Pretty big and lofty. So what do we do with these guiding principles? From these guiding principles, we establish our goals, policies, and programs. So our goal is our desired outcome. And from that, we create policies, which are statements of commitment that will help guide the city to achieve a goal. And then at the implementation level, we have programs which are carried out to implement and achieve a specific goal. Our draft land use element contains 7 goals. And as you can see, many of them do reflect similar qualities of our guiding principles. We're looking to preserve our neighborhood preservation, promote environmentally sound planning, and achieve economic stability, while also acknowledging that there is probably potential growth in appropriate locations. To highlight a couple of our land use policies that are more relevant for sea level rise, we have our open space goal, which is looking to preserve our open space lands for recreation while also protecting our natural resources. One of our policies is for baylands preservation, so really concentrating development on areas of land that are already developed. And then we have a program for San Francisquito creek setbacks, is to look at creating a zoning ordinance that would sort of dictate where development could be in proximity to the creek, so there's not the erosion. Another goal is sustainable services, looking to promote and implement sustainable development. There are a number of programs here, as you can see. The first is a policy related to hazards, so creating development that would only be in locations that would not be subject to seismic, flood, or other hazards, so long as, or potential impacts that cannot be mitigated. adaptation plan, to adopt an adaptation plan, to coordinate on their safer bay process, to create mitigation or measures for sea level rise, and to adopt a green infrastructure plan. And Azalea would talk a little bit about some of these items. So another component of our general plan update is what types of land uses do we want to see for the future? So again, here we have the map of the M2 area. And through extensive outreach and public input, what emerged was the idea of creating a more live, work, play environment. This would allow for introduction of new land uses such as residential, enhance more commercial serving uses in the area, but also retain the office and R&D that currently exists today. And so this creation of a mix of jobs, housing, and play would create more synergy and a sense of place. It would also hopefully create proximity to these uses and have the effects of a more balanced and efficient land use plan, which would hopefully potentially reduce vehicle trips and in turn reduce greenhouse gas emissions. The changes, as I mentioned before, are really focused in areas that have already been developed and where infrastructure for transportation already exists today with Highway 101, Willow Road, Bayfront Expressway, and potentially the activation of the Dumbarton Corridor. The plan seeks to create an additional 2.3 million square feet of non-residential development, approximately 4,500 new residential units, and approximately 400 hotel rooms. And just for context, the city currently has about 14.6 million square feet of non-residential square feet and approximately 13,000 residential units. So as I mentioned, one of the components is also the creation of zoning. And so outside of the general plan, we're looking concurrently with the creation of the zoning districts to complement the land uses that have been identified for the area. The zoning helps manage the physical development of the land, and we are looking at creating three new zoning districts for this live, work, play environment. We have office, which is generally in the sort of the blue, residential mixed use, which is yellow, and life science, which it's sort of hard to see, but it's on the right side of your screen adjacent to the blue, if you're familiar with near O'Brien Drive in the city. And each of the components of our zoning regulations would have four major components, the development regulations themselves. So we're often familiar with floor area ratio, how much square footage can we have, density, how many dwelling units per acre, setbacks, height, parking ratios. We're also looking to introduce design standards, so providing a common theme and a common thread for appearance in the city to create high quality sustainable development. We're also looking to introduce green and sustainable development regulations, and then we're also looking to address the community amenity. So in exchange for higher density or higher heights, there would be community amenities in exchange for increased development opportunity. Here's just a couple examples of some of the design standards that we're looking, that are being proposed. So building mass and scale. So we're looking at what are step backs. So how much a building should be step back from the facade at a certain height. Or projections, how much can a building project forward from a facade into a setback. Or modulation, how much variation should be in a building. And all of these help create visual interest to buildings. We're also looking at the relationship to the street. So often people know about max or minimum setbacks, but we may be creating maximum setbacks so that buildings aren't set too far back, so that we're creating more active street fronts, creating a sense of place, creating walkable communities, and really transforming the fabric of what is today a more suburban style area into a more urban form. So transitioning into, as I said, it's an exciting place time in Menlo Park. We do have a number of developments that have been approved. Some of them are nearing completion, some of them are under construction, and some of them are in the entitlement phase. So here, we have a number of approximately 650 housing units that are currently being constructed here in Menlo Park. Some of it is located off of Haven Avenue, off to the left part of your screen. We do have a new office development, often referred to as the Soprato development, that transformed what used to be a former distillery into two Class A office buildings. And moving on to what's happening on the Facebook campus. So here, again, this shows where we are today, the East Campus, and really gives you a visual of its proximity to the Baylands. But there are a number of things that are happening across the way. So Building 20, which is the newest Facebook campus, was recently opened last year. And one building at the curve of Chilco in the lower left side is under construction right now. And then there are plans for an additional extension, a campus expansion project for the remainder of the campus. And that's inclusive looking at approximately 1.3 million square feet of office and hotel use. And that project is looking to have potentially a late summer review process before the Planning Commission and City Council. And that site was formerly the TE Raychem campus, if people are familiar with that. So what are the next steps in our process? We will be taking all the input that we have received from members of the public regarding our proposed zoning ordinances and bringing that forward for consideration before the General Plan Advisory Committee on April 21st. The GPAC will hopefully be providing us with some guidance on where to make changes to, if needed, on our proposed ordinances, and we'll be bringing that to a study session before the Planning Commission in May. Following that, there will be the release of the Environmental Impact Report and Fiscal Impact Analysis in the May-June timeframe. And as I mentioned earlier, we look to bring all of the documents, our general plan update, our zoning ordinance update, and the Environmental Impact Report for consideration before the Planning Commission, City Council, and in the fall of this year. And just at the bottom for, I know we went through a lot of information here, so we do have a Connect Menlo webpage. It's listed at the bottom of the page. There are all of our draft land use and circulation goals, policies, and programs are available for review, as well as our proposed zoning ordinance regulations. And so, and I'm happy to answer questions after Azalea comes up.
Can you hear me? Well, thank you for being here. My name is Azalea Mitch. I'm a senior civil engineer in the Public Works Department. Over the past few months, we've been working very closely. Oh, can you hear me? Barely, okay, I'll project. Once again, there you go. Thank you. So, my name is Azalea Mitch. I am a senior civil engineer in the Public Works Department. And over the past few months, we've been working very closely with planning on the new proposed zoning changes, particularly as they relate to sea level rise. As some of you may know, in 2000, just last year, the Superior Court of California, San Mateo County, issued a grand jury report on sea level rise. And as part of that assessment, the report determined that the county is at a severe risk of flooding over the next few decades. The assets are highly vulnerable, and there is an overall lack of coordinated approach. And this finding is in terms of not only dealing with the existing flooding problems, but also with potential future flooding problems, particularly as they relate to sea level rise. The recommendations from the report are that we should act now, that we really need a single agency to undertake this effort on a countywide level, and that we begin addressing sea level rise through land use planning. We responded to this report in September in agreement of the findings and recommendations. As many of you know, sea level rise is here. The records from the Golden Gate Bridge tide gate do indicate that we've seen 8 inches of rise over the last century. while we can track existing and past, you know, we can analyze and track records from the past, making projections is a much more complicated effort. So in 2008, Governor Schwarzenegger at the time issued an executive order directing state agencies to begin planning for sea level rise. And as part of that effort, he directed the National Research Council to recommend measures for adapting to this. As part of the NRC findings, the study did look at the, as some of you know, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change models, findings from the climate models associated with that assessment. And they also incorporated extrapolations looking at the behavior of glaciers and ice sheets as they relate to this area. Those findings were incorporated in the guidance document issued by the Coastal and Ocean Working Group in 2013. So how do the projections look like? Well, the models indicate that by mid-century, the potential rise in sea level will range between 4 and 24 inches. The end-of-century scenarios indicate that those levels will rise between 16 and 65 inches. And what's important to note is that these scenarios are based on different models. The mid-century findings, the concurrence amongst these models is greater. So the guidance document, the study, determined that this range is likely to occur, whereas the longer range models are more uncertain. And that's because these projections are based on our future greenhouse gas emissions. And as we all know, there's a big question mark as to where we will be in the next century. So in terms of planning, when we look at these findings, we will be taking into account the level of certainty in these scenarios. Since the 2013 guidance document, the IPCC did issue a fifth assessment report. And in that, in those findings, they basically indicate that that sea ice is melting at more of an accelerated rate. So this really puts an impact on those projections. And what we do understand is that while we have the best available data based on that 2013 document, those projections will change as we learn more about what's happening with respect to climate change. And we'll have to be cognizant of that fact as we determine our planning level for that sea level rise. The M2, as Deanna noted, is we are right here, and the M2 area has this boundary. As you can see, most of the area lies within the 100-year flood zone. And what this means is that there's a probability of this area flooding, and it depends on that coastal event. Sea level rise, however, is a little bit different because unlike, you know, having an event with a chance of occurring, sea level rise will result in inundation that's permanent. Using the tool, web-based tool from Our Coast, Our Future, we're able to create maps that show different scenarios. And for the purposes of this presentation, we chose 3.3 feet. And as you can see, the impact of that inundation really extends, covers most of the M2 area and extends past it.
What does the red mean?
So the red is the level, sort of a degree of inaccuracy between the projections. The data were generated based on elevations and projections, and so there's an uncertainty. And the maximum boundary is sort of the worst case scenario, which incorporates those inaccuracies. Yes, the red zones would be underwater. When we look at the impact of flooding associated with that 100-year event and sea level rise, the area impacted is more extensive. And what we can do with this tool is basically assess what's the impact and what assets within these zones are affected by the increasing levels. The county, and I'm glad they're here, the county has really taken the lead in assessing this. They started a vulnerability assessment a few months ago that takes a look at the assets within the county. And these assets include things like hospitals, wastewater treatment plants, highways, roadways, recreational facilities. So as part of their scope, they will be identifying the assets. They will be creating maps that show different levels of inundation based on from 12 inches to 108 inches. They will be conducting an exposure analysis, so making an inventory of those assets that will be affected by the different degrees of flooding. They will also create vulnerability profiles and assess the risk of exposure, as well as determining do these assets have the ability to adapt to the rising seas. They will also create conceptual measures to reduce that risk. And that study will be completed at the end this summer. Once the county completes their study, we as a city will begin developing our hazard mitigation and climate adaptation plan. And what this study will involve, we will be identifying hazards, not just sea level rise, but other hazards related, such as drought, earthquakes, extreme heat, landslides. We will assess what impact climate change will have on these hazards. We will be using the county's vulnerability assessment to then create our own vulnerability assessment in terms of the assets impacted within the throughout the city, and as well as conduct a risk assessment and then develop our resilience strategies, which will be part of our how we adapt to these hazards. The types of resilience strategies that we will be considering to reduce that level of risk include things like zoning, which Deanna talked about. And as you can see from this graph, zoning has a significant impact in terms of reducing and addressing that risk. We will also be evaluating building codes. We will look at communicating that level of risk to our community in a more effective way. Also developing evacuation plans, as well as assessing to see if there, if we have natural storage within our watershed. We will also be evaluating the feasibility of levees and flood walls. So in terms of this effort, this is really at the local level. Individual property owners can also reduce that risk by incorporating additional flood proofing and also looking at insurance. So in terms of the resilience strategies, we will be conducting our plan or beginning our plan later this year. But what we have been focusing now and over the past few months has been really developing our green and sustainable building regulations. And the intent of these regulations is really to include standards of design to address some of the impacts of these hazards. Specific to sea level rise, we are looking at requiring that buildings include in their design that they accommodate sea level rise. And that would be done by placing that first floor elevation at a certain level. And based on the data that we're reviewing, we're in the process of figuring out what that level should be. We're also requiring or proposing to require that there be a fair share contribution to address the effort in terms of mitigating these hazards, and also including green building energy standards. You know, at the core of this is our energy consumption. So what can we do to improve our energy efficiency and reduce our greenhouse emissions? We are also working with the San Francisquito JPA on the Safer Bay Project, which Len will talk to you about in further detail. And, you know, historically, we have looked at flood protection really at the local level. And we're doing so through our zoning and also by planning for these hazards. But sea level rise it's quite a challenge, and it's also multi-jurisdictional. There is a clear need for really an agency to undertake this effort on a countywide level. Currently, the flood control district is discussing this option. Should they be the agency really undertaking this? The City County Association of Governments of San Mateo County is also in the process of evaluating that. And they created a water committee just a few months ago to really study that option. Or perhaps, do we need a new agency? So as Ann noted, there is a lot here that is evolving, a lot that is in the study phase, and we hope to come up with some solutions in the next year. So with that, I'll pass it on to Ann. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We are going to take just a few questions before we go into Len's presentation. So you've seen that cities are not expanding into the bay. They're using existing urbanized areas, but rather the bay is potentially moving into those urbanized areas. This is really different. And that's why it's important for cities to think about what they're going to be doing. And I have to say, Menlo Park has really taken a lead by involving itself at the local level, involving itself in the different efforts, and also with the county. And I did forget to introduce the county people who are there. I say TJ and Hillary are back there. The county has also taken a lead role in helping to really assess the county as a whole. And I know at previous events, people have said, well, gee, if Menlo Park's doing this, what's the county doing? And they're doing a lot of stuff now to help the cities in San Mateo County. So thank you for being here. We're going to take about 15 minutes max of questions, but maybe about 10. If you could come up to the mic if you have a question for the city of Menlo Park, please come on up. Don't be shy.
I had a question about the slide about next steps that are happening April through June. What of these issues related to the sea level rise are already in the planning, in what you're going to discuss about zoning and so on in M2? Are any of these things already ready to be presented if we go to any of these meetings in the next 3 months?
Yes, great question. So we have a couple of what will be going before the General Plan Advisory Committee in a couple of weeks. We'll be revisiting our draft zoning ordinances. So again, there are three proposed zoning ordinances, or districts, I should say, one for office, one for residential mixed use, and one for life sciences. Those are all now available in their complete form. So it identifies both their development standards and their development regulations and their design standards. And also, for sea level rise, it talks about, as Azalea mentioned, the green and sustainable building features. So those would be regulations that pertain to sea level rise, bird safe design, energy consumption, water, recycling of water. So we do have a number of measures that we did include in our draft ordinance. We also have heard concerns regarding our draft ordinance. So that's where our General Plan Advisory Committee will be providing us with some guidance on how do we want to proceed. But you can see our proposals in written form on our webpage.
Any other questions? Okay. Oh, and as you're coming up, I want to make sure that everybody knows we have a Menlo Park Council member here, Kirsten Keith in the back. Thanks for joining us.
I'm just wondering if the plan is involving the bay at all, building wetlands as a buffer. Is anyone talking with restoration of wetlands further out to help bring that wetlands up?
Yes, so some of you may know that the Ravenswood Salt Pond Restoration Project is underway. They had their environmental impact report out for comment a few months ago. It is quite a significant effort. The type of restoration, however, is a bit different in the scenario that, in the sense that they will be breaching levees to allow that bay water to come into the ponds. So the
the effort there, while it has a lot of benefits, it will really maintain the same level of flood protection. So we're not really putting that in terms of really addressing that or being a part of the mitigation in terms of sea level rise.
Sure, going up. Yep.
One more, and not to be facetious, but here we are at Facebook, and that was right in the picture there. I was wondering about this building, but particularly across the street, it reminded me of Hawaii, where people actually have their houses built up on stilts, and they can move their cars if they need to when there's, well, a sudden inundation, not general sea level rise. Is that kind of a preemptive architectural move before all this zoning actually gets into place for Facebook to protect itself? Or is that something you guys are considering?
So I won't speak for Facebook, but it is, as across the street, the architectural design does include an elevated design. It partly is to allow for parking below the building, but it can serve double as a protective sea level rise measure. I do believe that it actually is a couple of feet above base flood elevation. We're talking about this building. So the lowest elevation, I believe, is 23 feet above. That's primarily to accommodate buses and other circulation events that occur underneath the building. But even at the lobby levels, I believe they are above a couple of feet above base flood elevation. And so, as Azalea mentioned, for future development, so things that we're considering for potential land use change, we are looking at what should that minimum level be so that development can occur above potential sea level rise in the future. And so we are considering what that number is.
You had in the M2 area several hundred thousand square feet of office space under consideration and 4,500 units of housing. And so do you have a calculation for how many people will be employed in that number of square feet of office space? And does any of the housing include low income or moderate income housing?
Yes, good question. So we are looking at potentially a net new increase of approximately 2.3 million square feet of additional non-residential square feet. Potential number of employees, I would say it's probably about 5,500 new employees. In terms of the residential development, we are introducing 4,500 new residential units. It would likely be a higher density prototype. The program doesn't require below market rate or affordable housing. The city does have inclusionary housing for sale units. We are also considering a nexus study to look at ways to provide for below market rate fees for rental housing. On the one note, though, for development that's considering bonus level development, so for there's a base level development, and then for bonus level development, there are opportunities to receive community benefits in exchange for higher level of development opportunity. One of the things that's being considered right now is if you would like to go for a higher or a bonus level residential development, there would be inclusion of affordable housing in that mix as a requirement.
I don't know her name, but she'll be the last question. In
the slide, you'd indicated residents flood-proofing their homes. Other than jacking them up and putting them on stilts, what measures could residents possibly do to flood-proof their homes?
Good question. I think there were a number of, if we build levees.
You're talking about existing housing.
Do you want to answer that?
So one of the things that can be done is in terms of the mechanical equipment at your house. Normally that can be located or outside. Those types of things can be raised. This is the challenge, right? So the challenge is building up, but what can be done right now in terms of any things that you may have around your home is really elevating that equipment.
Can you please speak to what other mitigation efforts that Menlo Park might undertake? Like you mentioned levees, I didn't even know we had levees.
How powerful are they? Do we need more? And I know that there are certain things that can be placed in people's yards to allow seepage to occur more efficiently for rain and flood water, but so would that help us who live here and otherwise have to move? Or are we going to become like New Orleans and live under 6 feet of water?
So that's a great segue. Thank you very much. It wasn't even planned to our next speaker, who's going to be talking about different strategies. So you've seen the land use. You see what's here, what's being planned. And so Menlo Park, along with others, has been working with Len Materman, who's the executive director of the San Francisquito Joint Powers Authority, to look at feasible options. And so, without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to him because he's going to talk about, among other things, the things that you've just asked. So, Len?
Thank you. Okay, can everybody hear me? Great. So thank you, Anne, for organizing this, Anne Draper. Thank you to the League for hosting this, and thank you to Facebook for having us all on your exquisite campus. And thanks to Menlo Park for introducing the subject so ably today. Okay, so I run the San Francisquito Creek Joint Powers Authority. It's a regional government agency. We have a board of, it was founded by the City of Menlo Park, the City of East Palo Alto, the City of Palo Alto, San Mateo County, and the Santa Clara Valley Water District, which has flood control authority for Santa Clara County. Kirsten Keith, in addition to being on the Menlo Park City Council, is on our board of directors. So I'll get started. And we have a project which is called Safer Bay. Safer is an acronym and relates to, you can see there, flood protection, ecosystems, and restoration. And so today I'll talk about sea level rise and Safer Bay, and I think we'll get to some of the questions that were just asked. So, a week's worth of news. Unless you haven't seen any national or international press over the past few years, let alone the past 6 days, you know that the effects of climate change are going from bad to worse. Here's some of the examples, and so what we're trying to do is we're trying to not just think about strategies, we're trying to design strategies to actually deal with the issue. And this is a slide that I really love from John Englander. So what you'll notice here in the top one is there are several spikes over the last several hundred thousand years of CO2 concentration, and these are accompanied by spikes in global temperature. And these are also accompanied by spikes in sea level. The important thing about this graph is what you see at the very end in terms of CO2 concentration, which is now going literally off the charts. And that's why scientists expect to see temperature and sea level follow. It is not going to take as long to follow it as it has in the past because of the scale of the change in carbon dioxide concentration. This is another interesting slide to me, at least, and that is, and Azalea touched on this, the global average of sea level has risen rose about 8 inches in the 19 centuries before the end of the 1800s. It rose similarly about 8 inches in the 130 years since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. And in the last 20 years, it's risen at a rate of about 13 inches per century. So it's definitely accelerating. These various graphs, the blue lines that basically take the proverbial hockey stick kind of approach, there is a range of those, as Azalea mentioned, and there's a kind of a low end of the range and a high end of the range. And for our projects, we generally pick the high end of the range. Not extreme scenarios that you might have heard about. If all of the Antarctic ice sheet falls into the water in the next 25 years, but at the high end of the range, kind of as mainstream science right now, and I'll talk about that. Okay, this shows on the left what the bay looked like in the year of the Gold Rush, about the time California was established as a state. And on the right, it shows what the bay will look like if nothing is done in terms of sea level rise at the end of century. This is assuming a 6-foot rise in seas at the end of century. So what you can see if you look closely, or study this closely, is that, as Anne said, essentially the bay is taking back land that we, as a culture and people, put into the bay over the past 100 and such years. This is the area where we are now. You can see the Facebook campus where we sit on the in the upper left. And this image shows in blue the current FEMA floodplain map. So that's the 100-year floodplain. With about 50 years of sea level rise, that will be the daily high tide, which is kind of an interesting and easy way to think about the effects of sea level rise. Assuming it raises what we are assuming for our projects of about 36 inches over the 50 years. The tan areas that are shown on this map, again, this is a current state of affairs in terms of the floodplain. The tan areas are areas that would receive less than a foot of water. They might receive some water. They're also in what's considered the 500-year floodplain rather than the 100-year floodplain. Facebook's building, of course, is in a tan area. So Facebook's building wouldn't presumably have water in the buildings, although you couldn't get to the buildings under this scenario. And with sea level rise, all the areas of the map would be, all the colored areas of the map would be wet. This is just east of here on Highway 84. This is at the, almost at the on-ramp, or not on-ramp, but kind of raising of Highway 84 towards the Dumbarton Bridge, which is off to the left of the image. And this is the same location during a king tide. As people might know, Highway 84 at this location has seen water on it during many tidal events over the last couple decades. This is also, this is actually closer to this spot. This is on the right of this image. You see the PG&E substation, which is just to the north of Highway 84. I'll talk about that place in a little bit. And this is a levee adjacent to homes in East Palo Alto. Where the homes are located in this area, and actually in a good part of East Palo Alto below sea level, and the levee tops are above the roof lines. And that creates a kind of dramatic danger for some of these homes, especially in regards to the creek. The creek has flooded in the past, most recently in 2012 in East Palo Alto. And we've been working to try to start a project, which we intend to start this summer, a major project between the bay and Highway 101 along San Francisquito Creek. This is an image, finally, of East Palo Alto again during a king tide at a location that I'll show you in a little bit. So why is the Creek JPA working on sea level rise? One question I'll answer with some images. And what are our flood protection objectives? Talk about that a little more. Reducing risk is the first objective, and the second objective is getting people out of the flood insurance requirement. This image tries to explain why we're working on sea level rise and the connection between creek water and bay water. This image shows in areas of green that are, these are floodplains that are only associated with the bay. The areas of blue are only associated with the creek. San Francisquito Creek is that light blue line that runs through the middle of the image. It's the county line. It also divides Menlo and Palo Alto, and East Palo Alto and Palo Alto. And the areas in red are in both floodplains, both the creek and the bay floodplain. You can see the numbers. If you can't see it, there's about 3,500 properties in the creek floodplain, 2,700 in the bay floodplain, and 22 in both floodplains for a total of almost 8,500 properties. We have projects along the creek I mentioned between the bay and Highway 101 that we're planning to start this year. When that project is built, the area around that project will go from red to green, and that means that it will just be in the bay floodplain. It will no longer be in the creek floodplain. If you've driven across Highway 101 in the past year, you would have noticed why the circle is coming up there, and that's because there's a big project there that Caltrans is doing to the JPA's design specifications to is a flood control project, and it's also going to widen, as long as Caltrans is widening the freeway in terms of lanes, they're also widening the bridge, and it's a bridge over San Francisquito Creek. It's actually the lowest area of capacity for the whole creek system is right there. So there's a big project going on there. Unfortunately for all of us, it's a necessary project, but it'll be going on for the next 2 years. And then we have projects further upstream to deal with the creek floodplain. I won't go into the details on those today, but at the end of all these projects, we're left with a bay 100-year floodplain, just the green area. So the project that we're talking about today is called Safer Bay, and that's to get rid of the bay floodplain with sea level rise. The extent of the project on the left of the slide is the border with Redwood City. On the right of the slide is the border with Mountain View, and that's the extent of the project. It's 9 miles of shoreline. There are a lot of assets in this area. There are 12 miles of state road. That's the area shown in the orange dashed lines. The state has invested in the design and environmental documentation of this project, and they're looking to invest actually quite a bit more in the near future. Facebook, as we know, is affected by this project, benefits from PG&E as well, the substation there. There's also a lot of other development going on, also part of it Facebook in the kind of pink area that's right here, and Deanna and Azalea talked about that. There's also other infrastructure, the water treatment plant for the region, Palo Alto Treatment Plant, Palo Alto Airport, regional U.S. Postal Service facility, lots of businesses, et cetera. There's lots of opportunities for enhancing our natural assets. There was a question about marshes. There's lots of marsh areas in this part of the bay, and there's lots of potential marsh areas in this part of the bay. I'll talk about that, but there's lots of potential to enhance our natural assets. One of the methods of enhancing these assets and providing flood protection at the same time is called a horizontal levee. You might have read about it or heard about it or seen one. There's actually a prototype of one going on in the East Bay, and that is to basically build extremely gradual levee slope into the marsh and create different ecosystems on that long levee slope. So instead of a levee slope being like a 3-to-1 slope, it would be as much as 100-to-1. And it would basically be a gradual marsh that has increase in elevation. So what do we have to work with in terms of high ground? This is a LiDAR image of the area. And what we could see is there are several locations that are not yellow. Yellow is below 13-foot elevation. Blue in this image is 13 to 16 feet. And the kind of, I don't know what you'd call it, let's just call it red, is over 16 feet or more. And the areas that are circled that are most useful to us include, for this project, include Marsh Road On-Ramp, Bedwell Bayfront Park, and Palo Alto Landfill. There's some, and potentially the Highway 84 as it's heading east towards the Dumbarton Bridge. Probably it will be helpful to us. Actually more so than the landfill. The project objective, this gets to the earlier question in terms of our objectives from getting people out of the flood insurance program and reducing risk. Our project objective is the 100-year floodplain. FEMA just changed that in 2015. They went from a 10-foot tide, being the 100-year tide, to an 11-foot tide, being the 100-year tide. And there are new maps that came out in 2015. The image that I showed you a little while ago that was of that is from the newest map. And so these maps came out in 2015. They were called preliminary maps, and they're still being finalized. So I'll quickly move through this back to where we were. Okay. There we go. sorry. Okay, so the 100-year flood, the 100-year flood level of 11 feet, 2 feet of freeboard. The purpose of freeboard is to accommodate uncertainty. And 2 feet of freeboard is a requirement by FEMA for levees and flood walls and basically anything that tries to get people out of a flood insurance program. And so that plus 11 feet plus 3 feet of sea level rise, our objective is 16 feet. Now you think of a 16-foot high levee, it's not in relation to, let's say, the ground that we're standing on or that these chairs are sitting on right now. It's in relation to a specific datum that's set. And that datum exists for everybody that plans these types of projects. Another way to think about this 11 foot plus 2 feet of freeboard plus 3 feet of sea level rise, if we are just focused on risk and not on the flood insurance program and we build something to 16 feet, then it's basically the daily high tide plus about 8 feet. And so it'll take a long time, regardless of the flood insurance issues, for something that's built this high to be overtopped on any kind of regular basis by sea level rise. I mean regular basis meaning during extreme tides with sea level rise. It doesn't mean it won't ever happen. It just means that we're confident that we call this a 50-year project, just because when you build a levee and it's certified by the federal government, we usually think of these things lasting 50 years before having to be significantly changed. But we believe that it will be good for the 50 years. Okay, so what is the Safer Bay project? It's 10 interlocking reaches in 9 miles. So the first one is by Marsh Road, and then by Bedwell Bayfront Park, and then between the Bedwell Bayfront Park area and Facebook, and around the Facebook campus, and then up to the Dumbarton Bridge, and then along East Palo Alto. There are a few different reaches. I'll go through these. Then on the Palo Alto side. Yeah, sure. Reach is a segment of a project. So reach is kind of it's kind of a term that's used in public works projects or along stretches of waterways to define a specific area. And in the case of this project, and I'll show you these reaches individually, I'll go through them. We chose specific reaches based on physical features that ended or began that made sense to start one piece of a project at one element and then continue a different piece in a different element. So hopefully that will make sense in a minute. Thank you for the question. The final one is around the Palo Alto flood basin down to Mountain View. I have a question. How many people are here from Palo Alto? Great. Okay. All right. So I will not ignore Palo Alto. The one area I said these are interlocking reaches, the one area where they actually don't touch is between the pink and the blue, and that's right here, right? They're not touching. And the reason they're not touching is that's where the creek is, San Francisquito Creek. As I mentioned, it's the county line, it's the dividing line between the cities. They don't have to touch here because our creek project is right there too. It's those yellow lines that you see. And though our creek project is not just built to deal with creek capacity, it's also being built to deal with sea level rise. So it'll be kind of a seamless transition on both the Palo Alto side and the East Palo Alto Menlo Park side, if you will, to address future sea level rise. So here's the first reach. Marsh Road is on the right side of the image, and the blue line indicates one possible option. We have two options in this reach. The blue line indicates a possible option, and it goes along what's called the Bayfront Canal, and then it heads towards Highway 101 down here, and it meets up with the wall at Highway 101. The other option is the green line. And the green line basically goes to the on-ramp to Marsh Road. As you can see from this picture, the on-ramp to Marsh Road increases in elevation as you get to the on-ramp over the freeway. And so one option is to take advantage of the on-ramp there. The blue line has complications And I'll just talk through kind of some of the issues as I go through these reaches. The blue line has complications. There is a canal that's just on the kind of underneath the blue line in the image. And it's called the Bayfront Canal, and it serves as a drainage canal for North Fair Oaks and Atherton and parts of Menlo Park. And it is a constant problem with flooding. And we've seen flooding there as recently as 2014. On private property adjacent to Bayfront Canal. So that is a complication. Also, the city of Redwood City has not determined what the kind of long-term plans are for the Cargill property with Cargill. And so there's a lot of uncertainty there. And so what we want to do for our project is not have to, like all project proponents, is not have to deal with uncertainty. So we're looking very seriously at the green line as the preferred option. If there are any questions about that, I can answer questions, but we'll go on to the next reach. And that is between Marsh Road, which is on the left of this image, and here, let's see if I come around. Okay, so this reach, here's Marsh Road again. And basically, we would have to connect from where the other reach left off, and now we're heading east, right? So we're going to take advantage of the Bayfront Park elevation and build up a new levee here with tie gate, or water control structure, it's called. And then on the other side of the Bayfront Park, build up a levee here down to the north side of Highway 84. Now, somebody mentioned what are we doing in terms of utilizing marshes, and I think Azalea mentioned that there's a salt pond restoration project that's out there, and it's building new levees to enable the restoration of the marshes. Here, these marshes here are called R3 and R4, which are part of the Ravenswood Ponds complex. They are actually designing the exact same levee alignment as we are, with the exact same water control structure locations. And so what we're planning on doing, and we are doing, is we're taking advantage of their design, but they're not going to be building it as high as we are. Because as Azalea said, their interest is restoration. Their interest is not sea level rise, and it's not even flood control, really. It's just what they want to do is they want to build on the backside of these marshes, or they're not marshes now, but they will be, build on the backside of these salt ponds in a high enough levee so that they can degrade the levee along the bay and let tidal action come in. What we want to do is also build on the backside of these salt ponds, but we want to build to a higher level. So we're working with them to coordinate when they do their documentation, that it covers our project as well. So this is the only alignment. We looked at another alignment in this area, one that went completely along Highway 84, but this is the one that we're heading towards. Okay, next reach is between there and the Facebook campus. The Facebook headquarters campus is on the very right side of this image. Highway 84 is this roadway, as I think you can see. And so it's a levee along there. There are two kind of key issues associated with this, and one is land and property, which is a key issue in all of these reaches. And the other one is view from cars. So this picture was taken yesterday, and it's from not an SUV or a minivan or a bus. It's from a regular old sedan, relatively low to the ground. And you can have a great view of the salt ponds, right? And the person walking there along the trail. So with sea level rise, the whole area is wet. Their feet, they're not underwater, but their feet are. The elevation of that pathway is between 10 and 10 and a half feet. The whole area is wet every day, as well as the salt ponds. So the question is, how high can we build up there? In order to address sea level rise, basically, we need to build up a levee as tall as that person. Fortunately, for the car that took this picture, you could still see some of the salt pond. If you were driving in an SUV, you'd see more of it. But that's a consideration for people, is, you know, what is the view shed from the freeway? Is it going to be gone? It's not going to be gone totally, but it's going to be different, right? And people are going to have to just weigh that. That's part of the conversation, is how high to build these things. This is at the 16-foot elevation, the maximum. Now, if you remember back, I was talking when I was showing you that LiDAR image and saying 11 feet plus 2 feet plus 3 feet. We don't have to build that 3 feet right now. What we're actually designing is to build to 13 feet to get people out of the flood insurance program, and then enabling the 3 feet to be built later. If the funding and the property acquisition is in place now, we'll build it to 16 feet now. If it's not, we'll build it to 13 feet and enable an extra sections to be put on top and raised. This is what it would look like in that area. Facebook campus has a levee around it now, and that levee is not adequate to address sea level rise for sure. And so we've been working with the folks at Facebook to take a look at their levee and incorporate it into the Safer Bay project. There are options for the Facebook levee, but they're very basic. We build it up higher and we make it a certified levee such that the federal government certifies it, and it's part of the system that brings people out of the flood insurance program, et cetera. It's either going to be a levee or it's going to be a lower levee and a flood wall. There's a trail on top of that, which I think everybody wants to maintain. My understanding is Facebook definitely wants to maintain that. And a low flood wall, like a 3-foot flood wall adjacent or on top of the levee, adjacent to the trail, would serve the same purpose as raising the levee higher. So that's just a conversation we're having with Facebook, and thinking about it in terms of all the usual issues. How wide does it have to be? How much is it going to cost? What is the encroachment into the marsh adjacent to the Facebook campus? Okay, this is my favorite reach because it's so unbelievably complicated. So this is Highway 84. And here's the Facebook campus, Highway 84 heading off to the Dumbarton Bridge, which is over here. This is ponds R1 and R2, which are salt ponds. They're not slated for turning into kind of tidal action in anytime soon. They're on the long-term horizon for the salt pond restoration project. PG&E substation, of course. These are salt ponds that are managed ponds. There's a lot of money and work that went into those. The San Francisco PUC new pipe that's earthquake safe, that brings in water from Hetch Hetchy to the Bay Area, comes up right here. And then there's a rail line here, right? That is that was once and maybe again. And there are a lot of people that are wanting it to be again. And so there's lots of stuff going on there, as well as homes down here for East Palo Alto. And so we have two fundamental choices in this reach. The green line is, actually, let's talk about the red line first. The red line protects all of Highway 84, which Caltrans is really, really, really wanting us to do so that they don't have to do it. And it also goes around, it starts here where the Facebook levee ends, goes around the PG&E substation, goes all the way up to Dumbarton Bridge, comes back down, and then cuts across this managed pond called SF2, you see? And then it actually goes this way to protect the SFPUC pipe. And then it comes along the pipe area and the rail line, and it ends here, okay? So the red option protects all of 84. It protects the PUC pipe and infrastructure, and it enables the opening of these areas where the blue arrows are coming in for tides in R1, R2, and SF2. Okay, the green option is more cost effective. It enables the tides to come in up here, but not here, because here is an outboard levee that's managed by the US Fish and Wildlife Service, and it could protect the railroad down here. So what the green option does is it starts where the Facebook levee ended, and it's supposed to end here. And it gets from here to here by crossing Highway 84 at some location. This would be the closest crossing, and this would be the farthest crossing. If we did this crossing, we could still protect PG&E. Not sure we want to do that. But also, we could open up these ponds. Don't tell me I said that. But we could also open up these ponds to restoration. The strategy for crossing the highway is called a, what I'm calling a pop-up flood wall. It would be at one location, here or here or here or here or here, whatever. This is the farthest east it would be. And basically, it's been used in other states. It hasn't been used in California yet, but it works, and FEMA certifies it. And basically, it's a hydrostatic treatment that water gets on the roadway, sufficient water gets on there, and it creates pressure into a kind of a balance that pushes up the flood wall. If there's enough water, it locks into place, and it acts as a flood wall crossing the roadway. It would have to be so much water to raise it that cars wouldn't be on the roadway anyway. So it's not a kind of competition between cars and flood wall. So we're looking at these two options here. And if whatever option, wherever this floodgate that crosses the roadway ends up, it would go back along University Avenue, and then it would have to end up either on the south side or the north side of the railroad, have to end up at that same spot where the red line would end up. So the reaches get easier, you'll be glad to know, and quicker to describe. And basically this one extends from where the other one left off by the SFPUC pipe, and it goes all the way down to Bay Road, which here's Cooley Landing. Here's Bay Road in East Palo Alto, and there's not a lot of options for this levee. The key issue here is East Palo Alto specific plan for this area, which is called the Ravenswood specific plan, includes a roadway, a loop road that goes around this area, and it would be at the same location as the levee. So we're working with the city of East Palo Alto to try to make both of those things happen. The next option is south of there, and that is also in East Palo Alto. So here's Cooley Landing now on the top of the image. Here's Bay Road, and there's really no choices here. It would be following the existing levee. I will point out that some of the homes are very close to this levee, and the marsh is just on the other side. So what the challenge is there is to build up something that's higher than it is now and not take private property, which is not something that we want to do, or buy private property. We want to do even less, and not go into the marsh, because this is a marsh that is home to an endangered species. And building up into the marsh, even with the horizontal levee, which most people that think about marshes really like the fact that it creates added sustainability for the marsh. Even doing that in a marsh that has endangered species currently is problematic. So that's definitely going to be a challenge. The final reach north of the creek is similar to the other one, and I show just kind of what a horizontal levee would look like if it extended into the marsh. It doesn't have to, and it might not. It might not be permittable, but if it did, it would be a gradual slope into the marsh. At the bottom of this image, as you can see, is San Francisquito Creek, and so it ends the project in San Mateo County. On the Palo Alto side in Santa Clara County, the purple lines right here indicate the creek project. The yellow circle indicates where it meets up with the image I just showed. Basically, that yellow circle is down here now. The yellow circle in the next image. And on the other side, the yellow circle now shows where the creek project would line up with Palo Alto side bay tidal levees. The issues around this project are the runway at the airport. The FAA does not take kindly on building large levees right in front of a runway. And so, but we can actually help them. And we've been meeting with the FAA and have had very constructive dialogues with the FAA, which is great. And the way that we can help them is through what I showed before, the levee that, or the flood wall that crosses the roadway. The same kind of a structure can be put on top of a levee. And what that would actually enable us to do, when I say help the FAA, is we could actually lower the levee from what it is now and put that kind of pop-up flood wall on top. And so in 99.9% of the time, the planes have a clearer path to taking off than they do now. And during the main events of water, and of course these events will become more frequent over the course of decades, but during those events, the flood wall would pop up and wouldn't be an opportunity. But the alternative for the airport has very little protection right now, and the FAA has no budget or project in the works to do anything about that. And so we're working with the FAA, and they're being a good partner. The other part of the question in regards to the runway is just how close we build the levee to it right now. The Bay Trail runs along here. I didn't really mention, but throughout this whole area is the Bay Trail, which is a great asset. And all of our levee tops would continue or improve the condition of the Bay Trail in this area. That includes the area in that yellow circle. The Bay Trail is there around the Palo Alto Baylands, about around the airport south, heading down to the Palo Alto Baylands. And we're trying to decide in concert with the FAA just how close we build the levee that's parallel to the runway. Also questions about where we put the levee south of the runway. And then finally, getting to the Palo Alto flood basin, there are three options here. And the options include continuing a levee that rings the Palo Alto flood basin. I should say the Palo Alto flood basin is a very large area. Here's Highway 101. And it provides drainage for Matadero Creek and Adobe Creek and Barron Creek. And it's an important part of their flood control apparatus in Palo Alto. The current levee around the flood basin is where this green line is, and one option is to build that up. Another option is to cut the basin in half, open this up to tidal action so that water can come in up to this point and maintain this as a flood control function for the creek flow. And then the final one is to basically allow the entire flood basin to become new marsh and build up the creeks that were built up a while back in order to deal with creek flooding. So in 2000, a year ago or so, we had 11 reaches and 24 alternatives, and now we're down to 10 reaches and 16 alternatives for the SAFER project. And the goal is in the next about 2.5 months to, on those 10 reaches, develop one preferred alternative. And so this meeting and presentations to city councils and other public meetings are ways to gather input from people. So how are we going to do that? I'll really quickly go through this. This is kind of the methodology to get us from 16 to 10 options in those 10 reaches. We're utilizing the values of the project, including constructability, operations, ease of operations and maintenance, restoration, benefit, and recreation. And within those values, categories of values or considerations, which you see here, like cost and real estate acquisition issues and operations and maintenance and acres of marsh and Bay Trail improvements, this kind of a thing. Within each of those, we assess points. So for example, in the top left, the more expensive a project is, the less points it gets. In the top right, the more acres of restoration, the more points it gets. So we assign points, and then we have a scoring matrix that we look at all these things for all the different reaches and options within the reach. And based on the points that are given, we stick it into this, and utilizing the weight that we assign to each of these, construction cost versus life cycle cost versus construction schedule, et cetera, we come up with kind of a final number. And so that's a part of the equation. Certainly it's not all objective. This is a subjective and objective approach, but there will be kind of subjective considerations too, which is why we go and solicit the wisdom of city council members and other people like that, and you. Here is a summary of the project, design and analyze the project elements to get people out of the FEMA floodplain with sea level rise. Construction is not yet funded, and it may occur in phases. Phases in terms of geography and phases in terms of time. And each of these reaches is independently separable so that we can build parts of it separate from the others. The funders, as of right now, include the state of California from two different state agencies. Facebook is contributing funding, as well as the cities of Palo Alto, East Palo Alto, and Menlo Park, and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. anticipated schedule, as I said, now through the end of June, to engage key stakeholders by the end of June, hopefully, select a preferred alternative. It doesn't mean the other alternatives go away. It just means we have a preferred one that we start an EIR, Environmental Impact Report, to look at all the alternatives, including our preferred one, and we start design and complete that in 2018. And that's the presentation. Thank you very much.
A lot of progress in the last few years. We've learned a lot. So we have, again, questions that you might have. So please come up to the mic.
Can I say one thing before you start?
Yes.
People need to be escorted out. So I see some people are getting ready to leave. So we need to either have myself or one of the security guys escort groups out.
So, well, before you go, I want to say thank you so much, Facebook, for holding it. For hosting us here, thank you very much. Can we all give you a round of applause? We really appreciate your participation. So yes, everybody has to be escorted out. But please.
Yes, I think there's an elephant in the room and nobody's talking about it. And that is when we have an 8 Richter scale earthquake, which happens regardless of where we are in the phase of all this, and if it also happens at the same time as you have a king tide and an El Nino, which is a predictable probability.
Well, I guess my response to that is yes, that's definitely a factor to take into account. The requirements that are associated with building levees and flood walls are very stringent in terms of, in this area, in terms of building them to withstand sizable earthquakes. And I don't recall what magnitude on the Richter scale and what distance from the epicenter it has to be. Joe, do you have any recollection of that? But I know that that was an issue on our creek project, and we looked at the design engineers had to design it for I won't guess, but it was a very high magnitude earthquake within a certain distance, especially because the San Andreas Fault is just, just near Highway 280, very close to this whole area. Yeah.
I think you addressed this, but I just clarify. Most of the levees will be simulated marsh, or is it just solid concrete going in there? I mean, I'm concerned about the overall restoration of the bay and how healthy the water will be when we get through. What's the total amount of concrete that we're going to end up with that we used to have marshland?
Well, all the levees are earthen. There's no concrete levees. There will be an asphalt path on many of the levees, related to the trail. In terms of concrete, well, there will be concrete used in the areas where we use flood walls to set the flood walls, to have for the footings of the flood walls, but there is no question that this project will result in a very significant net increase in marshland for this entire area. This project could never be permitted if it didn't have an increase, and not only is it going to have an increase, it's going to have a very significant increase. The ponds of R1 and R2 alone, which is by the PG&E substation, are 600 acres of marsh, and those are not slated for becoming marsh in the foreseeable future. And we are very hopeful that those can become marsh as a result of this project, and we're planning on it.
How much will all the reaches cost? And it's good to see you have a funding plan, but how is the money going to be raised even from the state agencies and the cities as well?
Well, we have the funds. The funding that identified is to complete design and the environmental review process. It's not to construct. In terms of how much will it all cost, we don't know yet. We don't know how much it will all cost. And part of it depends on which alternative we choose, right? And so one of the factors, significant factors, is cost. In terms of the funding sources on how we would pay for it, I think it would be a combination of public financing through assessment And again, one of the benefits is getting people out of the flood insurance program. And right now, the average cost in the three cities of Menlo Park, Palo Alto, and East Palo Alto is about $1,300 a year. And that's escalating. If anybody pays flood insurance, they know that it's an escalating issue. And it will continue in the future. So one of them is an assessment district that really is described as a trade-off for building these elements instead of paying into an insurance program. The second one is the private sector. As was mentioned by Menlo Park, there's a lot of private development that's going on here. And that private development will benefit from this construction. And so it's on the table that the private sector contributes to public infrastructure in this way. And then the other is the state and federal government. You know, as I said, Caltrans is looking very closely at how it can help to finance the work that's specific to its assets, which is not only Highway 84. Highway 84 I highlighted in that one image. The US 101 is maintained and built by Caltrans projects. Willow Road is a state road. University Avenue is a state road. The state has a lot of assets at play here. Yes, ma'am.
First of all, thank you for this fantastic presentation.
Thank you.
I'm now worried that unless the whole bay gets itself levied, that the water will just flow around the edges of where you stop and come in anyway. Water will do that, you know?
Yeah. Well, there's no question that, so we have, we've been talking a lot with the city of Mountain View, and the city of Mountain View has been spending quite a bit of time and money to look at its plans. Interestingly, Mountain View also has salt ponds that are going to be restored, marshes, as part of the salt pond restoration project. And so the city of Mountain View has already done a lot of studies and is working on designs for its area. And our project ends at, show you in the Palo Alto one, our project ends at what's called Charleston Slough, which is right there, and that's where Mountain View begins, and they have a very specific project that is ending, and they're meeting up. So coordination with the city of Mountain View is really important. We have reached out to Redwood City. As I said, Redwood City is kind of undecided on its plans in that area, and so we just made a decision sometimes I feel like a lot of public entities are frozen by this big variability in the curve, right? It could be 20 feet of sea level rise or 2 feet, and so we shouldn't do anything until we know exactly what it's going to be. Well, we're never going to know exactly what it's going to be, right? And so at some point, you just have to say, I'm going to pick something that I think is in the best interest of my community, and I'm going to do something about it. And so we picked 3 feet, and we're going to do something about it. Redwood City, I hope they figure out kind of their plan. And whatever that plan is, it doesn't matter to me what the plan is. I'd love to match up, but I don't want to wait for Redwood City to figure out what they're going to do and disadvantage Menlo Park in the process.
So I want to put a plug in for the League right here, because this is why the League has said we need to get educated on this. And so that's why I encourage, if you're not in the League, to think about joining. Because not only the local leagues, but the Bay Area League said this is a complex issue. It may include taxing. It may include new governmental agencies. We need to understand and know about it. And also on the countywide level, we also, I think, need to talk among ourselves to say what might our role be to nudge, involve other parts. Menlo Park and the JPA have taken a leadership role, but there are other parts to our county, and there's also parts to the south. So little plug for the League of Women Voters right there. But I think Evan was next, sorry, and questioning, and then
if I could just finish the thought. In terms of Redwood City, I'm not trying to say Redwood City is not doing anything. What I'm trying to say is our project has to meet up somewhere. And if we don't know where it should meet up at the Redwood City border, the best that we can do is say the Marsh Road on-ramp is not moving. It's a logical place to solve our problem. Should we move forward and deal with that, and deal with it in that way? That's kind of our approach right now. Yes, sir.
I think my question's turned into more of a comment given what you've been saying. My question is about coordinating with restoration projects that may be under this Measure AA or other plans. It sounds like you're aware of them and are trying to find ways where you could save them money or they save you money or cooperate so that you don't block each other from doing something good. It seems like you're doing that.
Yeah, I mean, what we're trying to do is we're trying to say to, let's say Caltrans, for example, which is a really good example, or any entity that's a partner on this project. You are more likely to solve your problem if you work on a regional basis to solve the problem. So for example, let's just say PG&E. PG&E substation's out there, it gets water, it's an issue, sea level rise, regardless of sea level rise, it's an issue. If PG&E tries to propose a project that solves its problem 20 years after we build ours, they will never get the permits to do it under the current regulatory regime. They won't. So it's in their interest to join this project because this project will solve their problem as well as part of a funding picture, but also as part of a regulatory picture where opening up ponds, let's say opening up the marsh on the bayside of SF2, which isn't even touching PG&E, they can get permitting restoration credits for the work at PG&E. So if you look at it regionally, here's a summary. If you look at it regionally, you can take advantage of the funding picture from others, but you can also take care of you can also benefit from the restoration credits or benefits of the project in one area and apply it to another area. That's the benefit of all of us working together. And if each city tried to do it separately, it would be a much harder project for entities in Menlo Park or entities in East Palo Alto to do it not working together. Aside from the funding picture, that's an obvious one, right?
I have two questions. The first one's really short. I was wondering, how fail-safe are those pop-up levees? Has there ever in the history been one that failed?
They're fairly new. They have worked in real life situations in other parts of the country. Are they fail safe? You know, that gets to the question of passive active, and by active means you have to get out there and deal with it during an emergency. And so one of the considerations is, are they really passive? They call themselves passive based just on hydrostatic pressure, but that's something that we're taking into account. So thank you for the question. It's astute of you.
The other question is a little more complicated, and I don't even know if the information that I have picked up in the past is correct or not, but I was watching this television documentary a number of years ago, and it was talking about how just one more foot of ocean sea level rise would cause the salinity of the delta to become too high for freshwater use the way it is now. And so there was some mention of the building of a super dam outside of the Golden Gate mm-hmm. Bridge. Mm-hmm. And along with this dam, they talked about a pumping system to keep the water, managed. In thinking about that project, I never once heard any mention of perhaps incorporating in the super dam some sort of canal system so you can still have some shipping. So if they do build this super dam, it would maybe overall be cheaper than building levees all around the interior of the bay. First of all, is what I heard about the delta correct? And how about this super dam?
So I can't answer the question on the delta in terms of the salinity. In terms of the structure outside the Golden Gate Bridge, yeah, there was a design competition that I think BCDC hosted, Bay Conservation Development Commission, which is a state agency, a couple years ago, and they were soliciting ideas around some very large structure to bridge the Golden Gate Bridge at the water level. There are structures like that, right? In the Rotterdam has a very large gate. Okay, it was built and now it's obsolete already, and it's going to be even more obsolete, so they're having to figure out how to deal with it. But there are structures out there. Venice, I think, is looking at something. my belief on this, and it's kind of one of the reasons to step this project perhaps, is if that is built, it won't be built in the next decade, probably in the next two decades. And there are a lot of properties that are right now perhaps at risk, but definitely paying flood insurance. And I think that it's in our interests to not assume that somebody is going to come in and save us, but it's in our interest to save ourselves. And if nothing else, save ourselves from insurance payments that we don't need to be making. And so I think it's prudent to not assume that there will be a structure built at the Golden Gate. The regulatory issues around that are, I mean, just make your head go nuts. But let alone the who pays for it. Are the feds really going to come up with this much money to save the Bay Area? Is the Congress going to do that right now? I don't think so. So, you know, there's a lot of major questions around it that I think speak to moving forward locally.
And those are going to be our last two questions, and because we need to be out by 9 o'clock. So you're next.
I like your very pragmatic approach to taking FEMA and let's do it. I'm curious to know whether the various maps and charts of the reaches and so on are available on the internet to look at it more closely.
So this presentation, well, yes, they can. They'll be available on the internet, and so our website. In case you missed any of the slides, it's on the upper left. It's called sfcjpa.org. It's not up there now, but I will put it up there in the next week or so. Just the images of the reaches, and also this presentation and the Menlo Park's presentation will be on the Legal Women Voters website and convention.
Right. And you're the last question.
Okay. Just coming from a completely clueless place regarding these issues, it seems like this is a fantastic project, and thank you very much for explaining all this to us. And it's all about keeping the water out, but the planet's getting warmer, and we're probably not going to end having a drought. So is there any thought of using the water that's coming in to overtake us to use in our households and our gardens or, you know, whatever. I mean, put some use to that so that it...
Right.
Just a thought.
So that's a great question. And it's just a great question. And we spend so much money on... So most of our work at the Creek JPA has been related to the creek. And it's because the JPA was created in 1999, the year after a 1998 flood, as you probably know. And we spent so much time and money trying to get fluvial water out of here that are there ways to kind of, fluvial meaning from the hills and in the creeks, are there ways to kind of make better sense of that equation such that some of that money is spent along the lines of what you're saying? You know, all I can say is that the municipalities around here are do as much as any municipality to encourage water to be stored on land here, Palo Alto, Menlo Park, East Palo Alto, and the building of impervious surfaces on property. Our creek project includes in the creek project a pipe that's going to go across the creek to provide the city of East Palo Alto for the first time with recycled water from the water treatment plant. These are small steps that are in the right direction. And I think the long-term plan for that water treatment plant is not only to provide recycled water to Mountain View and Palo Alto and now East Palo Alto, but also to turn it into potable water, like they have a plant in San Jose, which would be great. I'm not really answering your question. I'm just talking about the small steps that are being taken. Short of kind of desalination, I don't think that there's a large scale solution to what you're saying. It doesn't mean that desalination should or should not be done. I don't know enough about it to say it's a good idea around here. But I think creating as much marshland as possible is probably in the right direction in terms of water quality for the bay itself. So, sorry, I don't have a better answer than that.
I want to thank you, and could we please thank our speakers today? I know that I've learned a lot. Thank you very much.